Welcome to the Cathedral of Shadows, where demons gather.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Cathedral of Shadows and Megami Tensei Podcast. I'm Rasen.
I'm Katsu.
Hi, I'm Johnny Awesome.
Hey, we haven't had you on in like 25-ish, a long time.
Yeah, it's been a little while.
Yeah, and then the one time we tried getting you on and then everything broke.
Yeah.
And then that episode never saw the light of day. So yeah, Johnny Awesome, how you've been doing?
I've been doing great, man. Thanks for asking. I had some ups and downs, but you know, life goes on.
Yeah, and now you're stuck with us, so
heck yeah, dude.
I've been looking forward to this. Yeah,
all right. I couldn't even sleep last night. I was like, I'm freaking excited. Oh my God.
Gonna talk with your two best buddies
here. Heck yeah, dude. Shadows.
We're here today to talk a little bit about RPG burnout, and this is not some sort of, that sounds like an RPG Maker spin-off program.
I know.
like burnout.
Like for pirating RPG Maker games or something.
Steve Greenlight.
Yeah, Steve Greenlight. This the shitty, I can't believe I'm saying this, the shitty version of RPG Maker. No, but, you know, us three here, we like the RPGs and...
We like the Rip Pigs.
Probably my second favorite genre, right next to boat simulators, yeah.
Boat simulator.
I'd say that's number one, definitely. But RPGs are okay, I guess.
Yeah. they're pretty great. They let me live out the lives that I can't have as a shitty woodland elf that had a horrible childhood or something. RPGs are fun, but one thing
I will never be eternally 17.
Oh, yeah. God damn it. One thing about them, though, is that they're really fucking long.
Yeah, most of the time.
And that could be a problem. Maybe not.
Well,
like...
unless it's Final Fantasy 13, too, and that's, you can just do that in like 20 hours.
Oh my God. Grind that out.
That's ridiculous. I never actually knew that. But yeah, like it's. I mean, maybe it's just me, but when I was younger, like that wasn't so much a problem. But now I'm older and like responsibilities,
yeah, busy, and I have adult responsibilities.
Yeah, so
gotta feed the kids, go get some bread. In that order, I guess. I don't know.
Yeah,
get the bread for yourself and eat it while the kids watch.
Yeah, there you go.
Just crying a little bit. Before we talk about that, we actually have one teeny tiny piece of news. So. The third Persona 3 movie, Persona 3 Falling Down, Falling Down, came out in Japan, and as it happens, there is a teaser for the next movie at the end of Falling Down, so it seems like the fourth Persona 3 movie is just called Persona 3 the Movie Last Episode, which is odd because people were thinking, because there's a little ticket thing that came with like a stamp or something in one of the releases of Spring of Birth, and it seemed to imply that there was going to be five movies, because
they're just trolling people, traditional Japanese trolling.
Maybe. it seemed like there was room for five stamps, so who knows, maybe there is actually only four movies, or maybe it's just the last episode of the main story, and then the answer can be its own little
What I'd like to thing. Think is that it's probably like, alright, let's see how well the last one does. If it kind of tapers off a bit, we might do the answer, because you know that's a sound strategy, right?
Yeah, maybe
marketing. Yeah,
I'd rather watch the answer animated than play it.
You know, yeah. I really hope they make it for that reason alone, so that when I have friends that play FES, I can go, "Okay, you beat FES," and then they go, "What's this answer thing?" And I say, "You watch this movie instead," and hand them the
Blu-ray. Don't bother.
Yeah, you watch the movie instead.
Yeah,
that'd be nice.
Unless the movie sucks too, in which case we're screwed.
The movie's instantly hard. You can't change the option. It's like, what?
It's depressing. So yeah, who knows what's gonna go on with that. Please look forward to seeing the great month of December in movie form.
That would be fantastic,
dude. We look forward to it.
It's gonna be great. Just all of that angst.
Oh yeah, screen. December. I hope that's like 30 minutes.
30 minutes of like, yeah, an hour and a half movie. We were talking about it a little bit before, but if you haven't seen Midsummer Night's Dream yet, it's out and stuff, and it's pretty great. Well, Katsu, I think you said last time you didn't like it as much as I did, but...
Yeah, I don't really like it.
Yeah, I enjoyed it. He's wrong. That's how opinions work. So...
Thanks for informing us.
Right. People just choose not to be right.
Okay. Right. This is how the podcast ends.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's a thing. But I guess we can go segue into our main topic. We were talking a little bit about it, but RPG burnout, as I guess we can call it.
It'll be coined from now onward.
Yeah.
I can't think of a better name.
Pretty much. I guess RPG RPG fatigue.
Fatigue, there you go. There great synonym. Rasen. I love it.
There we go. Okay, yep. So I think all of us here have played a long-ass RPG, and then halfway through it, we just stop, and then...
Tales of Legendia.
Not me, D.
Even though I stomached my way through the second half.
And then we continue to stop, and then we never go back to it forever, and it takes years to finish. So, actually, yeah, I was going to say, like, if any of us have stories with that, Katsu, you already...
Yeah, like, I was playing... The very first time I played Tales of Legendia, I was like, oh my god, this game is pretty fun. I don't understand why people hated it. And then I played the second half, and I was like, oh, now I understand.
Oh.
And then I kind of just stopped playing for like a year.
Huh.
I got back to it and beat it, though.
So, I think my worst thing is a game that I actually ended up never, ever beating. And that was a ROM I had of Final Fantasy V for Game Boy Advance that I had through the lifespan of probably four computers. That save file was 10 years old, I think, maybe.
Oh my god.
And then I finally lost the hard drive where it was saved on.
It's probably for the best, let's be honest.
Yeah.
So I got right up until the room right before the final boss. So, like...
Wow.
Literally one room and then the final boss, and it just I lost it, and that's why I haven't played Final Fantasy V forever, despite it being like my third favorite Final Fantasy.
Oh really? It is?
Oh yeah, I love that game. It's like 9 and then like 9, 10, 5 probably.
I guess I was just playing it wrong or something. No, I definitely was playing it wrong, but I was not totally invested in it. I beat that game like semi-recently, like a year ago.
Ah.
And I didn't understand at the time that Guild Toss literally threw your money away. I was like, oh my god, this move is awesome! It's throwing like ninja stars that are circular! And yeah. So I had like no money in like one of the last areas in the game, so that was great. But I had the chicken knife and I just one-shot everything, but...
There you go.
Yeah,
yeah, the chicken knife.
I can't think of any...
Or you can just throw Fuma
shurikens. Dude, I should... I probably play that game so long. I don't know. I just, here's the thing. I was coming on this podcast thinking like, okay, I need some stupid stories. Well, I've been thinking about it. I don't really like not finish a game. Like I just like kind of just burn through them in order of when I receive them.
Oh,
I don't think I do get fatigued actually.
You are a smarter man than I.
I think it's smarter. Just got more time on my hands, maybe.
Oh,
but.
Well, I'm looking at my I'm looking at my stack of Persona Q, Demon Souls, Dark Souls 2, Life is Strange, and just kind of tearing up a bit. Tales of the Abyss. Oh man, Fire Emblem Awakening. Oof. Yeah. I
actually got around to finishing Persona Q.
Oh, you did?
Yeah. I liked
it. It was good. It's just really hard to get into after you take a break.
Yeah, no,
but I slapped myself in the face and said, no.
Jump me enough.
You mentioned this, but that was actually the reason I had the idea for this episode, because I got burnt out on Persona Q so hard, and I'm still on the third dungeon. I was actually...
A little understandable.
I was playing more of it today, and I was kind of taking notes as to, like, what about this game burned me out, and I'm trying to... figure out when I'm playing an RPG, why do I stop playing it, and why do I not feel like going back, and then that's what causes the burnout, like what makes it that I don't want to go back and instead I play other crap or watch Gundam or do whatever the hell else I decide to do, not make YouTube videos and just make shitty jokes on our Megaton all day. And one thing that I think I noticed about Persona Q is that I didn't really pay much attention to it before, but like I actually decided to sit down and go, okay, what am I actually doing here? And this, I'm playing on Risky, so maybe this is different for me compared to other people. But the way that game goes, when you're going through a new area, well, if you're like me and you want to get every frickin' tile so you can get the stupid...
Dom.
the stupid treasure 100% chest or whatever.
Yeah.
That's one thing that's kind of like, okay, I need to make sure I'm doing this. But then also on top of that, I actually think the battles themselves are amazing. Like, I love the battles. I think they're, in terms of the Persona subseries of Mega 10, my favorite thing. Maybe part of it is because they're like a mix of Persona and Etrian Odyssey, and like, that mixture just is perfect to me. But like, the battles are fine. It's just that after about maybe three or four of them, your characters are pretty much near death, and one back attack means you just one game over.
One back attack is a GG.
Yeah, and I'm like, well, better go back. And then you, have, even though you have shortcuts, it's like, well, then you still need to walk all the way back.
Just constantly running back, having Elizabeth take your money, and then going back in there, progressing bit by bit, coming back.
And even, it really drains your resources just way too quickly, even on lower difficulties.
Okay, it's like you, that's what I was wondering. Like, maybe I'm just a dumbass because I picked Risky right away, but...
I'm playing on hard. I was playing on hard, and all my resources were drained really quick. Personas were incredibly expensive.
Also, one thing I did notice is that even when you do finally get to the point where you can... take out encounters pretty much no problem, like maybe you need to heal a bit afterwards or whatever.
Yeah.
You run into a situation where you can only carry so many, like, monster drops at a time, and it's like, well, as soon as that gets filled up and I can't actually carry any more things to sell, I might as well just leave so I can sell them so I'm not wasting my energy and not making money
from it. Wasting
inventory space. Yeah, so it's kind of this thing where it's like, okay, so I went from... three encounters until I'm near death to I went to six encounters and then I need to sell all this shit. And I just kind of realized, like, okay, I think this is the reason I got so burnt out on it. And like, I'm going back now and I'm almost done with the third dungeon. Like, I'm right before the boss. I could probably do it tonight yet.
Yeah.
But just, I was thinking about it and I'm like, I think this is the reason that like, I didn't feel the need to go back is because I felt so little progress, like I felt so little reward, I think, just maybe subconsciously, because you go pretty much room by
like
room.
I wasn't getting rewarded enough for all the shit I was doing.
But but then also too, like, it's easy to forget that feeling you do get when you reach this, like, you just not even reach, but you see the staircase.
Yeah, it's like, finally.
I did it.
So accomplished.
It's, yeah.
There's a lot of things that make that really made me dislike Persona Q. I mean, I have like a love-hate relationship with it. I really liked all the dungeon designs and everything, all the character relationships, especially the mirrors thing. Like, that was my favorite. Like, I don't know. I spent so much time doing that in the second dungeon. I don't know if everybody got... well, probably you got to it, but...
yeah.
Okay, whoever decided every time your inventory is full to make Risei tell you to sell all your crap... that wasn't a good idea. Don't do that. Come on. That was not a good idea.
It feels almost like they're a point where it's like, okay, you explore the dungeon, but don't get too far. And like, I've played other Etrian Odyssey games, but I'm not gonna lie, I haven't gotten past the first like area of any of them. And I don't know how common that is in other Etrian games, but because what I played in Untold and 4, it didn't seem like that was so much a thing.
Nah.
I could just be wrong, but...
I guess it's sort of an Etrian Odyssey problem, too. But yeah, the aisle storing stuff, kind of important. It seems like you just fill up way too fast in queue, because you're just getting resources constantly. And that doesn't really happen in EO, but...
yeah, and then you see the power spot, and you're like, well, I need to get this.
Well, crap, dude.
Power spot. I need to go there.
Yeah. But, I don't know. PQ had a lot of problems. Not really PQ, but the thing that really, I think, might contribute to your burnout specifically is that I forget what they're called. Estoma, I think it's Estoma something.
Yeah.
Reduces the encounter, right?
Estoma.
Yeah. Sometimes they just don't freaking work. Anyone else notice that?
Yeah, they kind of suck.
I don't actually, like, I don't think I've actually ever used those in Persona Q.
Oh, really? You should probably do that one day.
I should probably actually.
If you're complaining about three enemies.
Yeah, yeah. I actually don't think I've encountered it either as a skill or an item, unless I just didn't look at that part of the shop. I should probably do that, though.
Chances you have it by now, but yeah.
Are they, like, is there just an item that?
Yeah.
Okay.
You send the resources to Theo and he can make them.
All right.
I bought probably, like, 2,000 of those, and I still had to deal with a lot of random encounters.
Okay, I should do that, because
if it was something like Pokemon,
those items don't work.
Oh.
Yeah, like Pokemon has a really good system. You won't fight Pokemon, you still got to. But EO, not so much. It's like, all right,
if you don't want to fight them, too bad. You're going to fight them.
No, I'm just like, if you can't beat this game in an hour, you got to still fight them, man.
So. One thing, actually, though, too, I noticed with Persona Q, and this is specifically a Rasen problem, because like the other thing, I'm like, you know, I bet there's a lot of people that get the same thing, and you hear it all the time where people are like, oh, I love Mega 10, but I don't know, Etrian Odyssey is too hardcore for me, and I think part of that could be just like sometimes it feels like you're literally just going in and then you're not making that much progress, and then you have to go back and heal, and that isn't for everyone. Like, I can stomach that sort of thing because I grew up on like stupidly old dungeon crawlers on the PC that you would die over and over again, and then like I don't know, apparently I had nothing better to do as a kid, so like I went through a lot of those.
Gotcha.
Like played like NetHack and shit all the way back in the day. Fun stuff like that. But one thing I noticed that I think it's really only a me problem is before Persona Q, the Mega 10 I played before that was Kyuyaku Megami Tensei 1.
Yeah, yeah.
And one thing that game has, and that game's ancient, so a lot of
NES, like,
well, the remake, the Super Nintendo remake, but it's in a lot of ways it still feels like an NES game. Mm. One thing that game does that I love is that if you click the map button twice, it has an overall map of the entire game world. So you can kind of register how far you are to the end of the game.
Yeah.
Like, just a progress bar. And it actually makes me feel like I'm getting somewhere whenever I, like, go into a new area.
Mm-hmm.
And I loved that, because Persona Q, I know how many dungeons there are, and I know how many floors they have, but, like, there's no visual representation of that. And maybe just on, like, a minor level, that's why in Persona Q, when I get to a new area or I do something, I'm like, oh, I'm just kind of trudging along. And then in Megami Tensei 1, it's like, oh, I solved a little puzzle thing in this room. I feel like I'm actually getting somewhere because I can see how close I am to the final boss, from the start of the game.
I'm the exact same way. Like, I need to know how close I am to the end of the game to actually know how much accomplishment I'm getting. In most games, pretty much just like Final Fantasy and like traditional RPGs like that, really important to, you know, feel like you're actually progressing, at least to me. So I guess we have that same similarity in that regard. And Persona Q, this is the crap on Persona Q podcast today, guys.
Yeah.
But like, 3 episodes ago where it just came out, it's like, I love this game, and now we're all like,
yeah, no.
The one series that doesn't have this sense of, oh, you're progressing, you're getting to the final boss, it's probably Dragon Quest. But
I've never beaten a Dragon Quest game.
But they do all these other things really well that you don't feel like you need to have that, oh, how close I am to the final boss feeling.
You get a feel of, like, especially
Dragon Quest,
like,
games don't necessarily tell you where to go, but even then, it still feels like you're progressing towards
getting stuff done.
Yeah, or like in Dragon Quest V, where there's like an asshole that is the actual antagonist, but you don't really, like, he just does around and does evil shit, but they never really set it up as like, oh, you need to go fight this guy. So like, it actually just
feels
like
he's just an asshole, and you're just like, oh, I don't like
you. Just kind of wander around and like, oh, you're an asshole, so let me fix this thing. And like, you don't really have a sense of like a grand epic quest to kill a guy who is evil. It just like kind of happens side by side to the main plot. So yeah, Dragon Quest can be weird with that.
But Dragon Quest VIII was a lot more streamlined in that regard.
Really? Because that's the one I kept getting lost in. Wow, I feel stupid. Oh, well.
That's the one where there is an enemy for, well, yeah, there is some asshole that's just doing stuff, and like your whole goal of the adventure is to chase after said bastard.
Gotcha.
That's also a game that, like...
Yeah, it doesn't really tell you where to go, though. You kind of have to feel your way around.
That's also the game, though, that a lot of people, if I recall, are like, this could have ended 20 hours ago, and it would have been fine, and it continues.
It goes from, like, a 10 out of 10, then at that point, and then it drops to an 8 out of 10.
Which is unfortunate. Like, you guys ever have that, too, with, like... stuff where it's like, okay, this could have ended a little while ago, and we're still
Tales
going.
Of Vesperia is guilty of that. It could have ended at Alexei, but they just kept going.
No, I can't really think of an example like that. I mean,
I think most like Mega Ten and Final Fantasy games are actually pretty good in that regard.
Oh yeah, they're really good. Like,
yeah,
God, I'll never forget the first time I played Final Fantasy VI. You know, you get up to that one part where the game splits in half. And you're just like, God, this is it.
Yeah.
It's kind of weird on level 20, though, at the end of the game. It's not the end of the game.
Yeah.
And that's, like, a really great moment, but... Yeah, don't really have... I guess I don't have that much experience with RPGs, come to think of it, I guess, now. I haven't played Tales or Dragon Quest. Maybe I'm a novice.
I have played, like, 10 hours of Tales of the Abyss. I barely count
as really?
Tales. Yeah. And I just like Dragon Quest V a shit ton, so...
I tried to get through 8, and I eventually did, but my friend pretty much did everything.
Oh.
Yeah, maybe I wasn't the best person to bring on about Burnout, come to think of it.
It's okay.
Actually, maybe not, because I beat all of Persona Q in like 2 weeks when it first came out, and that was probably the biggest endurance run ever. I don't even know how I did that.
It's a long, like 50, 60 hours maybe.
Enjoy that last dungeon though, or second and last dungeon though, Rasen. You'll love it, man.
Oh, will I?
Oh yeah, you will. Oh. Some nice puzzles in there. You'll enjoy it.
Oh boy,
I'm sure.
I can't wait. See, what's weird is I love Persona Q, but it's just like, man, sometimes I really don't feel like playing it. And I kind of am at the same place with Strange Journey right now, except I'm going to disappoint a lot of people. I think Strange Journey's dungeons are fucking awful. Like,
no, they are.
Actually, they are just annoying. And this is coming from someone like, I played Soul Hackers, I played SMT1, I played Megaten 1. Strange Journey dungeons just piss me off.
No, they're so dumb. You know those areas where you literally don't have a map, and it's like, well, crap, I'm just going to get a piece of graph paper. What does this solve?
Oh, yeah. I actually... So dumb. Was playing the old school Megaten 1, like old school NES Megaten 1 recently. I have a stack of graph paper right here on my desk with maps drawn in Sharpie.
Rasen is old school as heck. Dude.
I felt like I was like 10 playing Zelda on the NES again. It was amazing.
Yeah, Strange Journey also really... That was probably a game I almost got burned out in because there's a point where it's just like, hey, you better press A on every single wall or you're going to be lost. And it's like, okay, cool. That's a thing. Totally not just going to look up a walkthrough.
Yeah, this is fun. Game of FAQs, where are you?
Yeah, it's one of those games. Outside of that, though, great game.
SMT Strange Part 1.
I talked about this before. I was talking about this in some of my streams. But, like, Strange Journey and Devil Survivor 1 were made the same year. And those are games that, like, I don't care for as much as other Megaten stuff. Mm-hmm. So
that,
like,
was the year that they were made were a really weak year for Megaten in general.
I think those were the only two. Like,
exactly.
Yeah. When did 4 come out? 27. Yeah, 2700. No, it was 07. And then, man, I don't know.
No.
Point is,
I think Strange Journey and Devil Survivor 1 were 2009. That was something like, I don't remember.
Really, that recent? Yeah, Devil Survivor did come out recently. That was kind of like the... Yeah.
6 years ago, but still.
Yeah, well,
it feels recent.
Yeah, it does feel recent. I got to make it since super late, so I wasn't even around for the initial release. I think the first game I ever got, Mega 10 Day came out, was like SMT4, so it's kind of a noob.
I don't even remember. Because I got into it like a little while before, but like...
Mm-hmm.
I think the first Megaton I bought as like an actual fan, like day one, was like Persona 4 Arena. So I'm actually not that old either. I'm basically a fraud. I have no right for this.
Gotcha.
Podcast.
Fake fan.
Pretty
fake.
Much. Yeah.
Big fat phony.
Yeah. I did not come out of the womb playing Megami Tensei 2 for the NES.
I know. I was thinking casual, dude. God. Know,
it's pretty disappointing. I also started with Persona 3. I'm just an overall fraud.
I mean, I feel like everyone did.
a lot of people did.
You're not alone.
You know, actually, that's one thing I want to talk about, too, is, man, those PS2 Megaton games were really long, and I loved them so much that I never felt...
Yeah, they were really long, like... Yeah, they were really long, but I didn't feel burnt out playing.
Yeah, no, never.
Yeah.
Especially in Persona.
I played Nocturne addictively.
Oh, same. Like, Nocturne's just like, oh my god, what is around the next corner?
Download like both Digital Devil Saga games as soon as I obtained them.
I have 108 hours in Digital Devil Saga, and 30 of those 108 hours are me grinding for Demi-Fiend.
Oh, same actually. That's like
I grind Demi-Fiend's
like his own game.
You actually can, if you had a friend over and told him or her to play Soul Hackers while you grinded for the Demi Fiend.
They beat Soul Hackers way before.
They would actually probably have 5 hours like change by the time they beat the game, and you'll still be grinding and trying to beat Demi Fiend. But even then, like, I never felt like I always felt fun, and like Persona 3 and Persona 4 especially are like, man, if you want to do everything in those games, and like I guess
it's gonna take a while.
I didn't really know what I was doing for FES, but for 4 I'm like, oh, I want to do everything I can, right? Just complete the experience. And like I put probably 90-ish hours into it, and I never felt burnt out once with Persona 4. Like, I loved every minute of it.
Persona 4 is really nice because I think it's mostly the dungeon design is a million times better. Like, just because in Tartarus, god dang, there are too many floors. I get it's a giant tower, but... Oh, man.
I actually don't have much, like, gameplay-wise. I don't actually care for three or, like... I think I like them about the same gameplay-wise, but I do feel like when you go through a dungeon in 4, it's more of an event, whereas in Tartarus in 3, it's like, oh, let's go to Tartarus again.
Oh, I gotta take the trash out.
Let's go to Tartarus again.
As much as I love 3, like, yeah, sometimes it's like, oh, let's just go to Tartarus.
Let's go with Tartarus
I think, too... Much. Every time you go into a dungeon in 4, you feel like there's a purpose behind it too, right? Where like
there's a time limit.
In 3, it's like, oh, let's just go to Tartarus. And like there are points in the game story too where like, do we even need to go to Tartarus? Well, let's just do it anyways. And it's like, oh, that makes me want to go through this tower. Okay. Let's just do it because that's where the combat of this game comes from.
Pretty much. I think a big thing with me and Burnout, now that I've been thinking about it a lot more, games that you can actively avoid enemies, I'll, like, just burn through, right? Like, Earthbound, Paper Mario, Dark Souls. That was a really weird 3 games to name like that, but I have nothing to do with the... Oh, my God. Whatever. Anyways... Because I don't know how you play Dark Souls. Actually, I do poorly. Just kidding, Rasen.
I just run
past everybody. I'm like, screw this. Running the boss, gonna die, and just keep doing it till dumb.
Yeah, but, like I'll I guess the whole stream archive isn't up. I just made a little highlight reel of it. But yeah, when I played through Artorias of the Abyss DLC, it was like my first time going through it. And as soon as I got to the boss door after the like first time, I'm like, you know what? I don't feel like fighting everything on the way here. I'm just gonna run past everything, go to the boss every time.
Yeah,
like that. I think helps a lot. And like you said, Paper Mario or Earthbound 2, where like if there's a way to just kill an enemy without even going, that's the best part about Earthbound, in my opinion. It's like, hey, if you run into an enemy that you can just straight up hit attack and you kill it, the game just auto wins the battle for you. And is the nicest feature, and I wish more games would do it.
I know. I mean, tangent alert, but I really hope Mother 4 does that. I don't know if you guys are remotely excited about that. I am
odd about it because, like, I'm one of those douchey Mother fans. It's like, it's not made by the same people. And,
oh my god, it's not made by Satoshi Iwata.
Yeah, like, it's... my thing with it is, like, Mother 3 and Earthbound are, like, my favorite games ever, like, to a point where I fully acknowledge that I love those games to a point of stupid bias where they're probably going to remain my favorite things on planet Earth until the day I die. Like, and I'm like, they're not going to make the magic happen again, and, like, I'm really pissy about it, but I'm going to try it out. And
I guess I'm a little optimistic, though.
Yeah, I fully know that that game actually looks pretty great. It's just
looks nice.
Yeah,
let's hope it's relatively as long as Earthbound. That's the only thing I'm worried about.
But. Oh, because, like, I'm just looking at it. I'm like, this looks fun. It's like, it's not the same. And, like, you know, kind of eating my ice cream and crying into a little bit, wishing Mother 4
your ice cream, drinking your Fanta.
Yeah.
It's my Fanta.
my orange Fanta in my mother's basement.
That's it.
No, like, actually, to be honest, I'm kind of fine with just Mother 1 through 3 as they are. I don't think there needs to be a Mother 4, but hey, that fan game looks pretty cool, so I'll try it out eventually, and maybe it'll take my heart, and that'll be fun. But, yeah, I do agree, though, with the whole RPG burnout thing can be totally avoided if you have systems like that in place. And actually, so, I get... A lot of people get mad when I say this, but I think Chrono Trigger is a game that has more flaws than people want to give it credit for.
Shut up.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm gonna slap you.
Exactly. So, what?
That game is amazing. was a gift from the god.
Hear me out.
Okay, we'll hear Raisin Boy out.
One thing Chrono Trigger does, where everyone's like, oh, it doesn't have random encounters. They're like, you go through and you can run past the enemies. But there are a lot of points in that game where you totally just
get stuck in an encounter.
Yeah, like, and I'm like, that's kind of dumb. But there's like a minor gripe with it compared to everything. Like, there are a few other problems. That game is pretty damn amazing, though. But just there's a few minor gripes that kind of pile up for it for me. But that was one of them where... I played it and I knew everyone's like, oh, well, you can just run past stuff if you want to do it.
But dang,
like,
you're right. That did annoy me.
Exactly. Because
I'm looking back on like,
you go through some areas. You go through some areas and it's like, oh, this thing is sleeping on a narrow bridge or something. Like,
yeah, and then you step on a leaf.
It's like, damn it, gotta fight through this.
Dang it.
Like, other than that though, like, one thing Chrono Trigger does though that like I actually don't know how other RPGs haven't still done this yet, at least well, is you go through every encounter that game sets up once, you have enough experience points and just skills to fight the boss and win. And, like, even Mega 10 sometimes isn't, like... I think Persona 4 actually... Well, like, I've heard they fixed it in Golden more so, but, like... Persona 4 Vanilla, at least, for some of the earlier dungeons, it's like, oh, I got to the boss door. It's like, no, I need to... Like,
now I need to go all the way back again.
Yeah, like, it's like I kind of need 3 more levels to get the skill I really want to beat this boss efficiently.
Yeah, it's
like,
definitely very well paced. I think the Souls series also does that perfectly.
Oh yeah, definitely.
Not so much Final Fantasy.
There's a few parts of Final Fantasy where it's like, this is a total gate and I need to go back and
Need to go back, grind up these levels. If you're playing Final Fantasy 2, you just have to punch yourself in the face enough more times to get the help.
God, that game is so...
That is the game that, like, I beat, and I'm like, you know what? That was the game where I'm like, you know what? If there's an RPG and I actually dislike it, and I get to the halfway point, I think I'm just going to drop it. Because I was like, you know what? Maybe I'll like it up until beating the final boss in the bonus scenario of Dawn of Souls. And I'm like, maybe I'll like it. And then I'm like, man, this game was a piece of shit.
I kind of did. I kind of liked the, what was it, Rebirth or something in Final Fantasy? I like that way more than the main game because you were like, you went from level 1 to 70 in like 20 minutes. It was awesome.
I actually agree with you. I think that was a lot better than the Final Fantasy 2. Remake Final Fantasy 2, but like give it a proper level system that doesn't make you
involve punching it yourself in the face like, to break the game.
And
like, everyone, let's punch Maria.
Exactly. Get 9,999 HP on everyone before the first dungeon, and like just remake that game with a proper level system.
It wouldn't be bad. The setting's nice. The whole
story is.
I love the story.
Yeah, the story's good.
It's pretty solid for an NES RPG.
The keyword thing for NES was really cool if you think about it.
Yeah.
I dug that, but
that's another game I felt burnt out on, but I somehow trudged through, and that was honestly a game I should have.
All right, I had to use emulation to do it. I beat Final Fantasy III NES legit Okay, not legit because I was using emulation, but still, like that's as hardcore as I've ever gotten. I still haven't tried Megami Tensei 1 yet. That's just on the to-do list.
Just play Kyuyaku. Don't even bother with the
NES. All right, man. I'll play both because I'm that hardcore, man.
I'm doing that right now for a thing that I'm making, and it's I would not wish that upon my worst enemy. Like, just play Kyuyaku. Trust me. Oh yeah, but actually another game that I think actually did the whole thing where you don't really need to grind too much was Final Fantasy IV. I thought was pretty good in that regard.
That's because you're stupid OP for the whole game.
Well, that's true. That game is pretty easy. The only time I had to grind in Final Fantasy IV was I got to the final boss, and I remember being like a little dumb kid and like going on game FAQs like, man, I can't beat this boss. And the guy that responded to me was like, okay, you're like 10 levels lower. I don't know how you got to the final boss. And I was like, oh, okay.
I guess I'll...
A little baby raisin.
Gotcha. It's pretty good.
Yeah, but...
Memories, man.
I know.
I remember the first time I went on GameFAQs, I was like, how to beat Thousand Year Door. Mario again. I don't know why I'm bringing this up so many effing times, but I was really dumb because I just put all my points into health and nothing else.
I did that too. And then the final boss kicked my ass.
Yeah. don't do that. You need some BP probably.
I actually didn't beat the Thousand Year Door until like 5 years later because of that. Like, I got stuck on the final boss and I just put it down. Then 5 years later, I'm like, oh, I should beat this. And I did. That's a thing though too, or at least I've done it with games or whatever, where I'll get to a point where like, oh, this is going smooth, and then you reach a challenge and it just kicks your ass and like
I've had that experience.
Demotivates you a little bit and it's like, oh.
Except Nocturne, because that's kind of the selling point. So you're I don't even care. I'm just gonna keep trying and trying and
that
trying.
That happened to me in this old ass PS2 game called Gaia 2 Dual Saga. I got to this point. Anyone who's played that game got to that point where you're in the canyon and then you have to fight this gorilla monkey whatever looking thing called Elfin.
That's awesome.
And it will freaking just wreck your shit every time. And it was the biggest cock block in a video game I've ever played, and I was like 10 years old at the time.
Like, Megaten, actually, I'd say that's... Megaten's a weird exception, because that is, like you said, the selling point. It's like, like this game's bosses will just destroy you. And actually, Souls, for that matter, too. But
I was about to say.
I actually also think that's probably part of the reason those games aren't necessarily for everyone, is it's like...
Yeah, no. Some people just can't deal with, like, stupid!
Yeah, some people don't have the patience for it, I know. Like,
Some people just want... Yeah.
Yeah.
Instant gratification, but
yeah,
that's one word for it
of many.
I don't have much else to say on the subject of
me either
burnt out on the RPGs, so I guess we could go to emails unless Katsu has another amazing Uncle Katsu story he wants to share with the class.
I'm good.
I like to view Katsu as my uncle.
I think more of a grandpappy. I don't know. That's just
Played all kinds of RPGs. Have anybody played Dark Cloud games?
Oh, dude, yeah.
That's I freaking love Dark Cloud. Yeah,
I know, right? Dark Cloud's the shit.
Confession, I got one at a garage sale for like $5 and I still haven't popped it in yet, but like 2 was my shit as a kid. I love Dark Cloud 2.
Dark Cloud 2 was amazing. That was another one. That was another game where I never felt like I was... You know, being burnt out on.
Random, you know.
I just kind of devoured that game.
This game is making me think of something. So, Dark Cloud 2. I think the reason I didn't get burnt out. Well, one, I was a kid and like infinite free time. But like, there's the little town building aspect of that game that is, in my opinion, the best part of that game.
Yeah, addicting.
And it's so addicting and it keeps you coming back. Like, that element alone was like, I'll keep going through the dungeon stuff and like grinding and all that just so I can make my town awesome.
Yeah.
And I just thought that was perfect. But this reminds me because there's another game I'm playing recently, and it's not really a JRPG, but it's a Western RPG called Pillars of Eternity. Someone sneezing.
You betrayed.
Oh.
The podcast. You played a Western. No, I'm just kidding.
How dare I? Yeah, I was Pillars of Eternity is fun though, if anyone's thinking of picking
Oh, yeah,
that
that's
up.
awesome,
Oh,
man.
yeah,
I want to
it's
shot
pretty
it.
great. Go buy that. It's like $45 or something.
Oh, frick.
Yeah. A little expensive, but it's a recent release,
It's
so
gonna
hey.
tap into my newspaper delivery money crud, dude.
Oh no. But it's a pretty good game, and it has a base building aspect thing. I actually don't think it's as good as Dark Clouds, but one thing that this got me thinking about is that Pillars of Eternity has a thing in it that I kind of feel happens a lot with games, like not even just Western RPGs, but games where there's like a shit ton of side quests or something, where you kind of get, I hear the term thrown around a lot nowadays, choice paralysis, where there are just so many things to do. There is, to quote Smash Mouth, so much to do, so much to see.
the frick?
I had to get that in there. Like that you're frozen, because it's like, what the fuck do I do? Like I don't know what side quest to do or anything. And I think one game that I think a lot of people can get behind me on this, Xenoblade is horrible with this.
Oh,
There
really?
is a lot to do in Xenoblade, and I feel like if you do every side quest of that game, you'll go crazy, because holy shit, there's a lot.
So much to do, so much to see. This is what I'm worried about with Xenoblade Chronicles X. They're talking about all this stuff you can do. I'm just gonna be like, oh, this is too much.
It's okay, because you can listen to that awesome battle rap.
Dude, I love
Yeah.
that theme, like,
Oh, different
so
planet.
much.
I'm just
I
gonna end the
love it.
podcast on it, fuck it.
Heck yeah, dude. I actually, okay,
Pretty
that's why I can't
baller.
get into Elder Scrolls. I'm kind of scared that you guys say that, because I'm really looking forward to Chronicles X, because, Gundam Unicorn, or,
Yeah.
OST guy. Heck yeah.
Yeah.
But, yeah, that's why I can't get into Elder Scrolls. I just, like, give me the funnest path, guys. That's
Yeah,
usually what I
I get
like.
that because especially with Elder Scrolls, it's like, oh, you're in a world now. Go do whatever. And it's like, oh, well,
Okay.
yeah, I
You
know a
end up
lot
doing the
of
dumbest things, and it's like, yeah, this game sucks. What the fuck?
yeah.
I don't want to harvest cheese curds. Like, God dang.
Elder Scrolls. Skyrim, I think, was really bad. Skyrim was weird because I feel like that as a whole game, it's like, let's do a lot of cool things, but not make any of them really that amazing. So, like, it's a game that's like, you can do this, this, and this, and this, and this, and it's like, wow, that's cool. And then you, like.
That's why the game is like heavily modded to the point where people like mod their own quests and.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I actually
You gotta
think
slay
that's.
Macho Man Randy Savage Dragon to get his hide and freaking
Yeah.
feed it to the village.
Mods are great. Like, because that's the thing though, with like at least base Skyrim, where it's like, oh, there's so much stuff to do, but none of it is really that fun on its own. It's just like
Yeah.
you have the option to do a lot of things, but none of it's really that fun at the heart of it, at least in my opinion.
Right.
But yeah, I think a lot of Western RPGs, I guess. I said Xenoblade before, but that game's kind of weird because it has more of an open style to it than most JRPGs do. I know a lot of people. I threw around the term choice paralysis before. I'd heard that definitely a lot with people covering Dragon Age Inquisition. I remember seeing a lot of people on Twitter, and actually, I think like a few journalists or whatever said like that game can feel so intimidating because you get out into the first area and there's just so much to do, and then you
Yeah, it's
realize,
huge.
yeah, it's huge, and then you realize it's just the first area of the game.
Many more, and it's like
Yeah.
kind of overwhelming a tiny bit.
Yeah, especially if you're a completionist, because I know for me, I love to do as
I
many.
am too, yeah.
I love to do like every side quest if I can. Like, I'm playing through Majora's Mask 3D kind of on and off. It's like my favorite game. And, like, I can't play through Majora's Mask without doing everything.
Yeah, you have to.
You have
100% is
to.
the only way. Like,
Yeah. Every heart container, every little dumb collectible, yeah, that's how you gotta do it. But like for something like a BioWare RPG, I kind of need to tone that down.
Yeah, it's. I think it's like a Western mentality that bigger is always better, especially in most RPGs. That are, actually, Dragon Age 1 was pretty good about
Well,
it.
that was a new IP, and they
Oh
were
yeah.
that suffered from new IP syndrome. So count
Yeah, I
that.
guess they didn't have all the time they wanted to make everything as vast, but.
Yeah.
That you say that, but that game actually took 10 years to make.
What?
Yeah, I know, that's ridiculous.
I did not know that.
No, I think the thing with Dragon Age is, I don't know, I think they wanted to focus a little bit more on the... I can't say too much because, like, I've played, like, the first hour of Dragon Age, and then I deleted the save file to focus on Mass Effect. But, like, at least from what I got, they wanted to focus more on the story, whereas with Mass Effect, it's like, oh, you got the whole galaxy to explore.
Mm-hmm.
And actually, that's another thing. I've been going through the Mass Effect games, and I got through... I decided to get Mass Effect, like, the trilogy bundle for PS3 just because two of my friends were like, oh, it's really cool, and they were talking about it over the summer. I'm like, oh, this seems like something I'd enjoy, and they kind of pressured me into it.
Mm-hmm. Pressure gaming? Gotcha.
Yeah, pretty much. Like, if you want me to play something, just yell at me enough in a Skype call on the weekends, and, like, I'll probably do it because I have no... I can't say no to people.
Speaking of games that I've yet to be burnt out on, no, never mind.
Okay.
Gotcha. Okay.
So I was talking to a friend, and I'm like, oh, yeah, I've been mostly doing side quests, just going through Mass Effect 1. And she was like, you should stop. And I'm like, why? I like doing side quests, though. And she's like, the side quests are probably the worst part of the game. You're going to get so...
Really?
Yeah. Well, the thing with the side quests is that they're not really that well written.
Yeah.
In most cases, and a lot of times it's go to this area and collect this thing, and then like a little window pops up telling you the story part of it, like not even cutscenes, just like little pop-up windows, and it's like, yeah, you got experience. And there's no real point to even doing too many of them, because just going through the main story, you're a high enough level to get to the end of the game anyways, so it really just feels like you're doing busy work at that point. And also too, a few of the side quests transfer over to affect things in Mass Effect 2 and 3, but not, like, that many. So, really, you're just kind of doing it for the sake of doing them at that point. And I was doing so many of them, and I got to a point, I'm like, I don't feel like doing these anymore. And I went back to her, and I'm like, yeah, you're right, and this is actually pretty bad. I'm just going to continue going through the main story. And I started liking that game a lot more after I decided that I didn't need to do every side quest available, because there's, like, 300 more of those than there actually needs to be.
It's always nice when your friend just comes and says you're playing this wrong.
Yeah.
Turns out you were! And it becomes more enjoyable.
That's
nice.
Basically my entire streaming.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Playing this game wrong. You're not supposed to marry Crom to her. You're supposed to marry Crom to her.
Exactly. I don't care about your headcanon. It's wrong.
It's wrong.
Immoral.
I'm right. This is my game.
Then there's the case of my Fire Emblem stream where I'm like, hey, I'm just going to do a permadeath run of Path of Radiance. Oh, that lasted all of 3 episodes. Oof. fucking rest in peace, everyone in that mercenary band. I don't even remember their names. Ike and then other people.
Ike and Pals.
Yeah, I was playing that game pretty wrong. But yeah, I guess we can go into emails if...
Yay!
All right!
Woo! All right,
love
so
emails.
We have a lot of the emails about the RPG Burnout. So this one is from Last End Conductor, and he says, no real question for this one, but I do have my own experience to share. I usually don't get traditional RPG Burnout, no matter how long a game is. If I want to finish it, I can enjoy it from beginning to end. However, I do get series playthrough burnout. I love playing games in a row, but I always get burnt out near the end. For example, I've never actually gotten very far in Final Fantasy IX, because whenever I want to play it, I also feel like I should play the previous games. So I've played games like Final Fantasy V, VI, VII, and VIII a bunch of times, but whenever I actually make it to IX is when I start to get burnt out. Despite knowing this will likely happen, it's still how I do things. In terms of Megaton, this has stopped me from actually getting to play Persona 2 because I get burnt out after playing Persona 1. Same with Rido 2. I should probably just start playing them individually, but it never feels right.
I think I actually have that happen a lot, too. It's like you really just want to do it in sequential order.
That happened to me with Dragon Quest IV. Like, after playing Dragon Quest V, I was like, oh, I should play Dragon Quest IV. And when I played it, I got burnt out pretty fast.
Mm.
It also doesn't help that Dragon Quest IV is a pile of garbage compared to 5, but...
Oh, really?
It's true. 5 is amazing, 4 is like, oh, this is fun, but not as fun. No, but I can definitely relate to this, because I used to do this stupid thing that I didn't get out of until like a few years ago when... I don't know, both because like I have less time and also because I don't feel like spending the money, but I used to be really bad with whenever I bought games, I would really want to buy the rest of the games in that series just so I had them on hand.
Yeah.
Which is why I own pretty much every Resident Evil game pre-5. And a lot of Final Fantasy games, and a lot of Mario games, actually. And I used to be really bad with that, where it's like, oh, well, I have... Actually, I did that recently. I think the last thing I did it with was Tales, where it's like, oh, I bought Tales of the Abyss, and now let's buy Azulia and Symphonia Chronicles, and now I have all these Tales games lying around.
And then they just started to build up.
Yeah, and then it's like, oh god, I'm never going to get a chance to play this. I need to stop wasting money.
How I usually deal with that is, I never play too... franchises back to back, like ever.
Yeah.
Like, I've been pretty good about that, I think. Keeps me, you know, it's like, oh, that game sucked. Hey, let's try something else. And, you know, maybe the game after that was really good in the case of Raido 1.
Yeah. But,
kind of how I've been doing it with Megaten, which, to be fair, like, it's still the same franchise, but that said, like, Devil Summoner is different than Persona, and Persona is different than mainline, like all that sort of thing. So I've been kind of avoiding playing like a mainline game next to another mainline game. I've kind of been alternating between all the different sub series and stuff.
I think Megaten is great for that.
Yeah, because they all feel like Digital Devil Saga and Nocturne. They're very similar, but
then you have Survivor and everyone's favorite Demikids. God, it's like freaking. They're the Beatles of RPGs, man. Can't they do?
I am dreading the day where I get to the Megaten list text document I have, and it's like, what's next? And it's like, oh, Last Bible.
Dude. I'm not doing that.
I am, because...
The Last Bible gritty reboot. Coming in spring 2016.
I feel obligated to play all the Megaten games in English at this point, and that's probably a bad thing, but...
I'm going to do it. Like, we gotta track down 9, dude. Come on.
Oh, Jesus.
Okay, boy, that's not English. That's barely English.
That's not even in English. And I doubt we'll ever. I doubt that'll ever be.
I'm gonna work on the patch. Yeah. Don't worry. I'm on it.
Easy open peasy. Open bounty. If anyone wants to translate SMT9, you can come on COS for like 2 episodes. Only 2.
Though. Yes.
Only 2.
Only 2.
Entire game translated.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's SMT9. Like, if you were to translate SMTF, like, I'd offer you a whole season, but, like, no. Or Last Bible 3. The last game in the series we really need translated. No,
saving the best for last.
Yeah, exactly. No, but, I can feel that, or just you play too much of a single thing back-to-back. And also, too, I think something important to realize is that in the case of a lot of game series, the games come out maybe at least a year apart, sort of thing. Like,
it's the thing with Tales. Well, they haven't had a new Tales game in, like, I think there was a 2-year discrepancy. No, a 3-year discrepancy between Tales of Exilia 2 and Tales of Hysteria.
That was 2012.
That's like the only exception.
Cause like you gotta realize too, like when you're playing them back to back, and I'm assuming you're playing them back to back at least. So it's like, oh, as soon as this one ends, I jump right into the other one. But also too, you need to realize that when it came out, like, people probably hadn't touched the other game for like a year or whatever, and they're like, oh, I feel like playing this now. So.
That's something to keep in mind.
Yeah, maybe like looking at it like that helps, because if you just go through an entire thing like that all at once, it's probably like more prone to getting sick of it, I guess you could say.
Yeah, well, definitely. Yeah.
So or like also too, just like maybe alternate between like going through another game series you enjoy. Maybe even like in the case of if you're playing a franchise of RPGs, maybe get like a little action game to play on the side for when you get bored.
I totally do it all the time.
Yeah,
when I think of it, right after Digital Devil Saga and Demi Fiend, I was like, oh, don't I start too? Jesus Christ, I'm gonna kill myself. Metal Gear Solid Collection, you know, and then after that I was ready to go again. So I was like, all right, cool.
Yeah, just need a little refresher series.
There you go. Thanks for the email, man.
Yep, thanks a lot, Last End Conductor.
Yay.
So this one's from Gonzalo, and he says, hi, Rasen, Katsu, and guest.
Heck yeah.
Guest. My question is, how long was your longest RPG burnout, and which RPG were you playing at the time? My most recent experience with RPG Burnout was with Tales of the Abyss. The fact that I discovered an amazing combo that killed every monster except for bosses that got stunlocked. And it was the second half of the game just wasn't as exciting. And then I got disappointed by the ending, and I got very upset and didn't feel like playing the games for a while, unless the gameplay was fun, in which case just laughed and tried to speedrun through the game. I think like he means maybe more genre-wide than just singular game-wide. I don't know. Like, I've always kind of played RPGs since I was like a kid, at least in some capacity.
I think we all have.
Yeah, like I never really stopped, I guess. Mm-hmm. Like, I had a brief stint in like when I was a little younger where like I kind of got into like competitive FPS stuff, and like I focused on that more just because that's what a lot of my friends were doing. And like
there was like a month for me where I just played Tony Hawk's Pro Skater. Does that count?
Oh, sure.
Okay. All right.
I don't know why that is so funny to me.
I know, it just is. Like, I just went through a phase, man.
I'm just imagining Katsu with like douchey skater shoes and like. No, like I don't know. I've kind of always played RPGs, like since I was like a little goober, and like I don't know, because like I always had like a interest in RPGs, but what really got me into them was when Final Fantasy X, like when that was new, like me and my best friend just like would like I would go over to his house every day after school and we'd play through that. Actually, shout out to my best friend's uncle who was like have you guys ever seen the movie The Wizard? And it's like the one kid that's super cool because he has the power glove. That was my best friend's uncle because he had the maxed out sphere grid.
Dude,
I know, and it was like, whoa, this guy's the coolest. And
a stud.
Yeah, I know, right? Good. And then. Yeah, I think...
How did that conversation go? We're seeing Maxdale Spear Grid?
Yeah, pretty much. Because he was the one who got my best friend into Final Fantasy X, then he got me into it. And, like, I always had, like, a passing familiarity with RPGs. Like, I'd played some Final Fantasy and, like, liked it on PS1. And, like, I'd played, like, Saga and Paper Mario and stuff like that on Nintendo 64. Well, Saga was on PS1, but... And then, like, I was like, "Oh, I like these." And then
also, I did
Final
have
Fantasy
that.
Final Fantasy X got me into it.
That Saga was for Game Boy. What the frick? y'all teach me today. What the frick?
I did have a stint of playing Super Mario 64. Does that count too? No. But I think everyone had that.
Yeah, everyone had that. Like, that was the game, dude.
Yeah.
Playing Super Mario 64.
That was Saga Frontier.
That was like actually, I'm pretty sure my first game.
Really?
Yeah, like, because I didn't really know what video games were, and I went over to my cousin's once, and he was like, let's play this thing. I'm like, what the fuck is this thing that he thrust in my hands?
What kind of board game is
this?
First
game was Final Fantasy VI, though. It was Final Fantasy III in America.
Yeah.
Dang.
That was my first game.
No, actually, I think I've told the story before, and I thought I was 4, but I actually looked up the dates, and, like, that actually isn't possible, so I must have been 5. yeah, I think I was 5, and like he showed me probably the best 2 entries into gaming I could have asked for, which is Super Mario 64 and Ocarina of Time. Yeah.
Final Fantasy 6 was the best entry for me.
That's pretty strong.
My entry was for the longest time I thought the NES was the only gaming system. Turns out my parents just really didn't want to buy me anything better. So
that
eventually...
was my thing too, actually, for a while.
I know, right?
Like, oh, Nintendo 64, I want one of these. It's like, oh, we have this thing in the basement, we got your sister, and it's like, oh, hell yeah, Mega Man 2, and played that forever.
Mine was like Mario Kart 64 and then Ocarina of Time, and I was just like, all right, I'm a gamer now.
Yeah.
I made the conscious decision.
Do the games thing now.
I'm a game guy.
Anyways, we kind of got off subject. Well, longest,
oh, yeah, we totally
did. Longest RPG burnout, but I think we kind of answered it. Like,
okay. Yeah. Oh, for me, I have not played a Final Fantasy game in forever. Like, literally, like, 2007 was when I beat Final Fantasy IX, and I don't think FF14 counts, but that was the last one I played, because literally, after playing Shin Megami Tensei, I'm just like, I don't like Final Fantasy anymore.
You know, I'm kind of at that point where I'm like, oh, hell yeah, Final Fantasy 13. Oh, never mind. This is garbage.
This is Final Fantasy 13 wouldn't have been as bad if that was like the only thing.
If it was named Spider-Man RPG or some crap, I don't know.
It was named like Lightning and Friends.
Yeah.
They're like, oh, yeah, like, that game wasn't that
but
bad.
But then again, we have to deal with Final Fantasy 14 1.0, and that was like a pile of dog doo-doo.
Pretty much.
Like, I have this Type 0 English patched PSP ISO on my computer that's looking pretty good right now, but it's just a matter of me actually popping that in one day. God, yeah, I don't think I actually played a Final Fantasy since, like, I got burned out by 13, and, like, SMT just filled the gap I needed.
I also wanted to get Type 0, but it's like, but there's no demons. I'm literally a slave to the franchise.
I know, it's like... Type
0 HD has, like, a lot of issues.
Really?
I've heard a lot of people say that, like, the transition from Type 0 being a portable thing to being an actual console RPG has actually hurt the game, which is sad. Yeah. But apparently the camera is god-awful. I've heard that from almost everyone.
Yeah, the camera's really worse. It gives me a headache.
Oh my god, really? Is it that bad?
Yeah, it's really bad. It has, like, severe motion blur.
Oh, that's the worst.
There's no sensitivity options.
You gents have saved me a lot of money this podcast. I have to thank you for that.
Like, it'll literally make you sick.
That 15 demo is looking good, at least.
Yeah,
you could buy like a 15 demo on eBay. The 15 demo is like really fun. It's just so much fun.
I've never had that much fun
playing a Final Fantasy game before.
Yeah. So yeah, thank you for the question, Gonzalo. The answer is none of us ever we never stop the RPG party.
We're too hardcore.
Yeah, it's
get like, good.
My longest thing was probably like 3 months because I was too busy playing like Call of Duty and being a dumb little white kid.
My longest stint was like a month because of Tony Hawk.
Yeah, so. Tony Hawk and Call of Duty are truly what kill JRPGs.
Oh, yeah, and I'm a true gamer, so...
Yeah.
All right.
We're on a roll, man.
We are.
Five-minute tangents every email. We'll get this one done next year.
Yeah, I know.
Do it!
It's okay.
I love this, man.
I can't wait for the response. It's like, I asked the question. Like, what the fuck?
So you talking answer about the Tony question?
You're talking about Tony Hawk.
Dude.
Just going to name this one Tony Hawk Tangents, fuck it.
Do it, dude.
All right, so this one's from Lodo. Hi, Lodo. And he says, this is my second email to the podcast. He says, for burned out RPGs experiences, I really think only FF7 was the only game I got burned out on.
What?
And he says, you stopped playing around the time you meet Sid for the first time.
Oh, wow.
Then he says, hope he has a wonderful rest of the day. Final Fantasy VII, I don't think I got burned out on, but I played that when I was like, God, I played Final Fantasy VII in like a stage where I'm like, oh my god, Final Fantasy's the best.
No, it's
I played Final Fantasy VII when I was like 9.
Dang.
So I remember getting Final Fantasy VII, and then I eventually somehow lost that copy, and fun fact... the copy of Final Fantasy VII I have now, the only way I could get it was off of eBay for whatever reason. Like, I probably, like, I don't know, it was probably before, like, I used Amazon for shit. And, like, it's like, oh, I'll buy Final Fantasy VII off of eBay because I have enough money from whatever. And the only way I could get it was a cracked, like, it has, like, a little crack on the copy. Actually, I have a video with my copy of Final Fantasy VII, you can see it. There's like a little crack running through it that looks horrible. But the only way I could get that is if I bought it with like a combo pack with like Final Fantasy, The Spirits Within, and Advent Children.
Heck yeah.
So
Spirits Within.
Yeah, God, that
do you know that movie cost Square like so much money they never recovered from it?
Yeah.
They never made the money back for like a couple of years.
Yeah, it. I actually have it between my copy of Blade Runner and Donnie Darko just to confuse people when they
my friend holds his PC up like to keep it off the ground with those exact two movies. He did not like Advent Children.
It's funny that you mentioned that. And that was the whole that was like the whole cloud emo. That's where it really kicked off.
See, because you know what's weird is that Final Fantasy VII Cloud isn't even really that emo. Like,
no, he's not at all.
Because like he's a little grumpy gills for the first disc or whatever, and like he's like, oh, girlfriend died, and like then like he becomes kind of like goofy, like a little bit like towards the second half, like he becomes a little more charming and
like the whole time during Advent Children
destroys his character.
Yeah, and then Advent Children just completely like. edgy. Yeah. He is basically the kid that would make a Kingdom Hearts parking lot video.
Yeah.
Scarily accurate.
I'm going to link that video in the description. People are going to be excited.
Have you never seen dual wielding in real life, dude? you got to do yourself a favor. I played Final Fantasy VII like way late, like when I got a PS3. I don't even remember. Yeah, I played it pretty late. Like I don't know, I just burned through it like in a week. Everything.
Yeah, I played through it really fast because like I was like,
you're OP, dude.
It was my peak like of the Final Fantasy fanboy.
Yeah,
in my young
years.
I think
that was a lot of people's peaks.
Like I feel like six
was for half and half. Yeah.
Yeah. Does anyone else feel like that game was kind of meant for like 7-year-olds though?
Final Fantasy VII?
Yes.
Oh, that was totally that was. Okay. I was gonna say like I feel like that game was meant for like live journal teenagers that like think the story is like a lot deeper than it actually is.
The heck is that?
Yeah.
The story
was pretty cut and dry. Live journal.
Hey,
at least everything about Final Fantasy VII was fun.
See, that's the thing. I like VII. Like I liked it enough that like I was addicted to it for a while there. Like even more so, like 9 is my favorite Final Fantasy, but even more so than 9, I really like got invested in 7. I'd say.
8, I got very invested in 10.
8, like I wish. Like my thing with 8 is like I want to like 8, but like the battle system kind of depresses me. But yeah, I don't know. Like all 3 of those PS1 Final Fantasy games, like I got really into. So like maybe nowadays, maybe I would have got burnt out on 7, but who knows.
What was the question again?
It wasn't really. It wasn't really a question. He was just saying.
Oh, it was just a statement.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
I told people to email their experiences.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I feel like we just really just glazed over that. Feel bad. All right.
No.
I didn't know we didn't.
No. Yeah. Like I've been meaning to go back to a lot of games from my childhood forever, and Final Fantasy VII is one of those because like.
So. Speaking of games from my childhood, anyone play Sonic Adventure 2?
Yeah.
Especially, yeah. So when it came out on PSN, I think it was like a year ago.
Yeah.
I was like, when I was playing it, I was like, this game sucks.
Oh, it does.
You know, so
it sucks.
I have a story about this. So what I realized Sonic Adventure 2 was not as good as my childhood would have me believe. I was over at a friend's and like... So this guy is not much of a video game player. Like he's one of those guys like racing games and like first person shooters.
So he's not an epic gamer.
No, if I were to show him Persona, he would probably call me names and laugh at me.
Like a good friend. I like it.
Yeah, and then he'd like slam dunk and make me feel bad because I can't jump as high as he can, and he beats me in every sport we play except for frisbee, but that doesn't really count. Can't really beat anyone in frisbee. What the fuck am I even talking about? Whatever.
I don't know, but continue.
So like I was looking at like his PSN game list because we were like thinking, what the fuck should we do? And it's like Call of Duty, Sonic Adventure 2 Battle, what the fuck? So he's like, oh yeah, I loved that game as a kid, so I bought it again. And I'm like, oh my, like really? So I'm like, fuck it, let's play Sonic Adventure 2 Battle. And me and him went through it, and like he had downloaded it like I think 3 months prior, but he just never actually played it.
Yeah.
So he's like, oh yeah, I feel like playing through like childhood game or whatever. And I'm like, oh yeah, let's do it, fuck it, I loved this game when I was a kid. And we're like, man, this is not held up at all.
The game sucks. Like I think the only thing we really remember, Pro Jared did a review of Sonic Adventure 2, and he was absolutely right. The only good things we remember are like the Sonic and Shadow stages, the Chao Garden.
Yeah,
Chao Garden is still the best part.
How do they not brought back Chao's? I don't understand that, Sega.
Yeah.
You just make a Chao game and make a fortune.
Yeah, you can make.
Makes no sense.
Kinds of money. You just put Chao.
Like they made a Chao iOS
such a commercial
game.
Failure. They put the Chao Garden in there.
Dude, I will say one thing about Sonic Adventure 2 Battle. That is a really fun game. Just beat in one sitting and just make fun of all the cutscenes because they're so asinine.
Yeah.
It is like good time.
And the music for that game is like extremely well done.
Oh, yeah, I love music.
Down in like 2001.
Pumpkin Hill. That's still my workout song to this day.
Pumpkin Hill is really good.
Oh,
Pumpkin Hill's legit. All people think I'm trolling. I'm not, dude. Pumpkin Hill.
Yeah, Pumpkin Hill is good. I like that.
I don't chuckle. That's all I'm gonna say.
All right, thanks, Lodo, for the question. That was Lodo's question, right? I started looking.
Heck if I know. I don't got the emails.
It was Lodo's question. Thanks, Lodo. Moving on. So this one is from Muddy Junk, and he says he's fairly tolerant with long RPGs, even ones with obvious padding, but he's noticed a few things that drive me to take long breaks from games, and it mostly comes down to speed. The best thing that Megaton games get right is that most of their battles are relatively engaging without dragging on. Persona 3, he says he's beaten like 10 times now because the battles are quick, generally optional, and retained an element of tension if you don't use New Game Plus.
Yeah.
Which I agree with. And then he says another thing that makes a huge difference is navigation. When a high random encounter rate radically slows your progress and makes basic movement a chore, it's a lot worse to play.
Yeah. Persona 2.
Yeah, I was thinking literally Persona 2 walking down a hallway,
I know,
getting five lockers in, and then random encounter with the poltergeist.
hey, at least
remember me.
Soma,
wanna fight
that. In that game was really potent, though.
And then he says most of the stuff just comes down to how much the developers respect the player's time. And then he says, even filler can be to some extent fun and thoughtful, but when the basic mechanics and structure of a game feel stiff or time wasting, that's when the game starts to lose me. Which
that's
I absolutely
agree.
That's
why
with.
I can go back to like Diehack GU every year. Oh, like I've seriously played that game once a year for like the past 3 years.
I couldn't. Those are too repetitive for me. I started playing GU and I was like, this is fun.
Well,
like...
I have the custom soundtrack matchup, so.
Oh, okay.
That actually probably like spends the gameplay for me.
I think another series that I tried out not too long, like a while ago, but not too long ago, and it's like, I can't enjoy this, but I could see why someone would, is Disgaea, where.
Yeah.
That game series to me just feels way too like padded out and like grindy and like.
Dude, I love this guy.
See, because that's the thing.
9,999. Yeah, beating everyone's ass.
Exactly, that's the thing where it's like I feel like this isn't for me. Like
no, yeah, it's not so much that it's a bad experience at all. It's just like it's different tastes.
Yeah, it's like how invested do you want to get? And for me, it's like I don't feel like getting this.
There's like one guy in IGN's inner circle that actually likes this guy. He's like my favorite game reviewer because of that.
And then he just ends the email off by saying, dig the podcast, looking forward to the next one. Sincerely, Muddy Junk. Thank you, Muddy Junk.
Yeah.
I think we'll go one more.
All right.
Well, man, I can go all night, dude. Why are we resting now, man? The night is still young. Okay, we'll go.
It's like 10:30 my time.
Man,
11:30 yours. Okay, so this one's from, hope I'm pronouncing this right, Grisha. He says, hello, I hope you have a good day. Sorry, I'm not a native English speaker, so my English is kind of wonky. That is okay. So, question number one is for Johnny Awesome. Is there any...
Frick.
This is for you. This
what the heck?
Directly. He says, is there any LP which you started to record a few episodes of and then said, nope, I'm done, can't do it, and then dropped the project?
Holy frick. Oh my god, no. Let me actually look, because I'm not sure. Because I upload all my recordings, I just never publish them. So let's look. Sonic CD, that was it. I was like, F this. Because the whole time I was like, man, I'm going fast. And that was obviously to make for very good commentary.
Oh.
So now
it's just going fast.
I was hoping there was like just like 800 part Happy Wheel thing.
Like, yeah, I was like, I'm gonna need to
YouTube money cash in LP that is like, you know what, let's not.
Not just Sonic CD. Sorry.
This is question number two is for all of you. What do you think of series burnout? Like, if you play a lot of FF, and then you feel so burned out with that style of gameplay, you just drop the whole series. Like, I think we kind of covered that with the last email. It's like, yeah, gotta alternate, man. Like, can't just play through all at like everything at once. Or like, if you're gonna play through like a series, maybe like dish it out a little bit with like spinoffs just to make it feel more fresh. Because generally, spinoffs change things up enough. I guess it depends on the spinoff.
I'd like to think, though, that there's one man out there who's played every single Final Fantasy in order. In
like my god.
There probably is.
Probably, that is.
And people on the dev team.
I know, yeah. Maybe.
don't know.
It's just that hardcore, dude. We can't match his gamer prowess.
I can't do that. Like, I've played through 1 through 5. Well, almost. I didn't fucking beat 5 because lost the stupid save file. 7, 8, 9, 10, 12.
I played all of the main, well, except for 13.
I gave up on 10. I couldn't do it.
Oh.
Blitzball, dude. I'll try it again. I'll get it for PS4.
Wait, you don't like Blitzball?
No. I don't like Blitzball either, to be fair.
I love Blitzball. It just sounds like so my silly. Favorite Final Fantasy minigame.
I feel like we have...
I want Blitzball to be in Final Fantasy 14. Katsu, they have Triple Triad in here.
Katsu, I feel like we have the Blitzball conversation once per episode now.
Blitzball and FF14 will happen eventually. Give it the third expansion.
They're going to put Blitzball in here, and I am never going to leave the Gold Saucer ever again. I'm just going to stay in there and play Blitzball all goddamn day. It's like, oh shit, I have to raid, but Blitzball.
And then he says, if you got an ability to go back in time and you got the ability to change something in SMT, story-wise or gameplay-wise, what would you change? But you can't say something like make it more popular.
Oh, yeah.
Because it's too obvious.
I got mine.
You go, because I'm still thinking of
mine. Okay, great. All right, so I'm going to bust into Atlus Incorporated or whatever the dump they called it back then. I don't know. In 2000... When did Stranger Theory come out? Doesn't matter. I'm gonna be like, alright, who decided to make freaking invisible walls that you have to scan to go through? And I just feel like, hey, just don't do that, and the game will be a billion times better. Because maybe I'm stupid and don't remember correctly, but I felt like that happened every other millisecond, and it drove me insane. It would have been
great. Here's mine. Mine is rather simple. Remove Yuzu from Devil Survivor 1.
Oh my god, he hit the nail on the head, boys.
It was actually 2009.
Holy frick, I'm a god. I'm the true Mega Man fan of the podcast.
I don't know. I think
just remove Yuzu from Devil Survivor and it would be game of the year.
You still got Midori, though.
Oh my god, and her dub voice,
I can tolerate Midori so long as Yuzu's not there.
You still have Midori, and you still have the dumb subplot that every electronic in Tokyo for some reason has a microwave chip in it, that the government somehow decided that was a sane strategy to do to counteract invasions. Yeah, there's a lot.
I'm playing the right game, what?
Yeah, there's a thing in Devil Survivor 1 where they're like, oh... Every electronic in Tokyo has, like, a little chip in it that the government can activate and, like, microwave everyone.
Oh.
Or something.
That.
I hope I'm remembering
that
right.
Yeah, that's kind of dumb.
I hope I'm remembering that right.
You are. I remember
okay.
now.
Okay. It was something like that.
Yeah. Pretty good character Devil Survivor 1 has. That's too bad. I've noticed that.
And then... yeah, I'm thinking, like, what would I change?
There's a lot of good characters in Devil Survivor 1.
Yeah, there are.
You know what? I don't know if I'd change anything. I think it's, well, like, okay, maybe make SMT9 not happen. Like, does that, like, that or Rond, like, one of those two?
Dude, Rond, alright, we'll save this for another day. But y'all hate us, so I'm gonna just leave it at that.
Okay.
Okay. I know this is not relevant to the email at all. What if they removed Del Saujo from Nocturne?
You know what? I feel like the game would actually be more fun in a way because you can't just use that crutch the whole way.
Screw through. You.
Okay.
Del Saujo is my greatest ally, my best friend, best demon.
Like, you know what that literally is? Is the tranquilizer pistol from Metal Gear Solid 3 where it's like, this is the best thing and I love it. But if you take it away, the game requires you to, like, be more creative. Yeah.
Yeah. But who cares? Because it's awesome.
Yeah, it's odd because it's like it's fun with or without.
I know there's a self-imposed challenge to not use that pistol in that game, and I guess it'd be the same in Nocturne. But
no Daisojo run.
Dude, that'd be a hard run. But, like, screw that.
Yeah. Like, for me, I don't actually use them that much because, like, I get prayer or whatever. Yeah, it's prayer, right? Like, the last healing skill, and I just, like, pass it on in inheritance. But,
yeah.
You lose out on the stupidly amazing meditate spell. So.
So good.
Anyways, yeah, I think we're done here. I guess.
We can talk about the Mass Effect thing.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Oh, frick!
So, I have a friend who happens to have a friend, and he, the friend of a friend gave that friend a Steam code for Mass Effect 2, and he's like, I don't want this, I already have it, you take it. But that friend also already had Mass Effect 2, so he gave it my way, but I already have Mass Effect 2 for PS3, and then I got...
I also have Mass Effect 2!
Gasp. And, and then it's like, you know what? We were talking about it, and it's like, you know what, let's just do like a giveaway thing or whatever. So, hey, if you got this far, you get in on this the super secret contest. This is your reward for actually listening to this for the hour and a half or however long we've gone. So,
jokes on you, I just skipped to the end.
Exactly. if you're listening to this and you want a Mass Effect 2 Steam code, email us at cathedralofshadows@gmail.com. Tell us your favorite episode of the podcast and why. It doesn't even need to be that long. It could literally be like, I liked episode 17 because of the one joke you made at this timestamp. Or like, it doesn't even need to make sense. It could be just garbage, and I'll just pick one randomly out of a hat.
So you're telling me if I email you poop code, please, I could have a chance to win?
You're missing the episode number, but like, yeah, like if you put if you put like poop code 32, maybe like.
All right, someone's gonna do that now.
My standards are so low.
Okay. I want a code.
I thought you said you had the game.
I know. I just want it.
Okay.
Others not have anyways.
I'll probably just pick one randomly or something, and then I'll reveal it, and then I'll just email you back with the low key after the podcast. Whenever we decide to do one next, so like 2-3 weeks from now, whenever next COS comes out. So yeah, if you want a, I'll repeat the instructions again. If you want a Steam copy of Mass Effect 2, email us at cathedralofshadows@gmail.com with favorite episode and why. And yeah, I guess we can just plug our shit. I mean, Johnny Awesome, you're a special guest here. Do you want to say anything about what you do or
no?
Okay.
But if you force me, I am a primary weeaboo game let's player here on YouTube. Chances are you're watching this on YouTube. You should head over to my channel where we play games that no one likes or enjoys. Yeah, pretty much.
I don't have... Actually, I do have kind of a lot to say, but like, I'm not going to say it because I have a bad history of making promises that I never keep.
Okay.
To my one friend who wants me to play Ace Attorney, I'm sorry, because that's been a year and a half in the making.
Heartbreak.
It's okay. It's the same friend who wanted me to play Mass Effect, and I'm going through too. She's not listening to this, but I may be doing a little bit more stuff that I'm working on, writing scripts for, and just kind of getting together editing that you might see on my channel in the future. Just some personal solo projects I've been working on, and I think people will like a lot. Some more high-effort stuff than just having a picture and then audio in the background. So that should be fun, and hopefully I can get that done soon. I have university crap and all that stuff I've been worrying about, but I hope I can make some more YouTube-ish stuff in the future other than just podcast. And I know a lot of people have been kind of bugging me. I don't know if you've gotten this, Katsu, but like a lot of people are like, what's the next episode and all that, but... we're busy, and also just we
think we have adult responsibilities.
Yeah, we I think might not go back to weekly ever. Just it's hard, and also not gonna lie, the news flow in the past couple months has been a lot more tame compared to past fall, where like everything was coming out and everything was being announced and got less to talk about. So I think we're just gonna have some more chill, relaxed episodes like this, and just talk about whatever and it'll be fun. Don't worry about it. We're not dying. It's just...
Well, technically, everyone's dying all the time.
Eventually, we're on the heat death of the universe, and... No, yeah.
Time is the ultimate apex predator.
Wow.
That kind of came out.
Wow. Holy shit. Wow.
I was talking about Father Time, man. From Devil Survivor 2. Come on.
Whoa. I didn't think I have my new tattoo quote.
Dude.
So, yeah, just, I hope you have a fun day, everyone listening to this, and, don't even play video games, they're pretty terrible, just
stay in drugs, don't go to school.
Yeah.
Swag.
420s in 2 days.
Protection, right? I'll get you wherever you go.